Hey everybody, welcome to our Space Club Career Chat. I cannot believe we are in week 7. So there are 8 missions in Space Club, so we only have a few more of these career chats. And I know you guys have a break next week, so thanks for joining us this week. Next week, we're also gonna take a break and then we'll be back the week after. All right, so introductions. I'm Natasha Wilkerson. Here we have Aspen again joining us with Communities and Schools, your mission control team. Today's going to be a little bit different. So we, instead of one guest, we have 3. And we're really excited. So we're going to do the presentation a little bit different. But before I get to that, I got 2 questions already in the Q&A wanting to know if we're going to announce the mission patch. We do have that winner. We're going to announce it at the end after we talk with our guests, so stay tuned. Okay, so our 3 guests today, they are college students at the University of Texas at San Antonio in Texas, and they also conduct research with Southwest Research Institute. You saw some of their work in the video, that STEM Space in Depth video that it was assigned this week. So our first guest is going to be Lizeth, and she has a bachelor's in physics, and she's currently studying, pursuing her PhD in physics and astronomy at UTSA. We also have Caleb. He has a bachelor's and master's in physics, and he's also a graduate student or a PhD student in physics and astronomy. And then last but not least is Jacob. He is currently an undergraduate student in physics, so it's his senior year, so he will be graduating soon. He's trying to get his bachelor's in physics with a minor in math, and he's also working full-time as a technician at Southwest Research in the Space Science Engineering Division. All right, so the way we're gonna do this, I'm gonna bring each one of them on to share some information about their background, some of their hobbies, and then we're all gonna talk together, kind of do like a panel discussion and ask some of the questions that you had. So for everybody watching live, feel free to ask questions in the Q&A box and we will ask those towards the end. So starting us off is gonna be Jacob. So Jacob, if you wanna turn on your screen or your camera, and unmute yourself. Welcome.
Hi, hello.
Hey, so go ahead and just give us some background. I mentioned, you know, you're a technician at Southwest Research. What do you do?
Right, so here at Southwest Research, mostly I keep the instruments that we use to conduct all of our experiments in running shape. I try to fix any issues. I do a lot of the experiments myself, and I gather the data and I put it into graphs for our meetings so we can discuss the results and stuff like that. That's what I do here at Southwest Research, at least.
So you're a technician. So to get that role, did you go straight out of high school?
No, you don't technically need a degree to be a technician, actually. I think you just have to have the aptitude for working with your hands in a scientific way. A lot of that is trained. I didn't start in space science when I started here at Southwest Research. I actually started off in the biotechnologies division or department. And I learned a lot of the ways through vacuum technology and stuff like that there and kind of moved my way over to space science where my passion was.
Very cool. Yeah, I'm excited to have you because a lot of the speakers we've had have had advanced degrees. And so that's what the students are seeing, that you need a bachelor's, a PhD to work in these STEM fields. But what I'm hearing from you is that you don't necessarily need that, right?
No, you don't. As long as you have the passion, you can, and some aptitude, and as long as you have the passion, you can get the aptitude. You know, you don't need a degree to be able to be useful for these high level kind of topics and stuff like that. You just have to really put in the effort.
Yeah. Awesome. We'll ask you some more about that here at the end. And I was going to jump to your next slide. So here are some of the hobbies that you sent me. So just tell us a little bit about what you do for fun.
Yeah, so as you can see, I'm a pretty big nerd. I have a 2-year-old son, so most of my time is dedicated to work and playing with my son. I like taking him on hiking trips and taking him outdoors while I can and how I can, you know, during this whole COVID thing going on. But beyond that, you know, I like playing video games. I like sharing me playing video games with my friends. They enjoy watching and we have a good time talking and stuff like that while I play some of the more retro games like from Super Nintendo and stuff like that. I also really like tinkering. I've been learning programming, so I've been tinkering with a lot of breadboards, a lot of things like turning LEDs on, moving, you know, certain things, photo sensitive objects and stuff like that. Yeah. Fun kind of programming and tinkering with that. And, you know, I also enjoy playing card games with my friends, Magic the Gathering. I don't know who knows about that or anything like that. But yeah, it's fun.
So if a student is interested in coding and robotics, how do you recommend they get started?
Well, I actually found out the same way I would actually suggest anyone else to find out is through a website called SparkFun.
Yeah.
And SparkFun, they have all sorts of Q&A and a whole blog on how to get started, and they have certain kits that are meant for certain ages, and they can walk you through everything, and they have step-by-step. It's almost like Lego instructions for anyone who has absolutely no idea on how to get started. And so you're given a breadboard and a couple of lights and a couple of moving objects, and they talk you through how to program onto your computer chip and your breadboard and how to talk between the two, and how to basically code and what you need to code in order to move those things. And it takes you advanced steps from there. And so it really helps you from the ground up, from knowing nothing to being able to program, even using applications here in space science.
Awesome. So that website was SparkFun, you said?
Yeah, SparkFun, that's right.
Perfect. Aston, if you want to put that in the comments.
Sure.
Cool. Okay. Thank you, Jacob. So we'll get back to you again at the end when we bring everybody together. So next I have Caleb, if you want to join us. Coming online.
All right.
Hey, Caleb.
Okay. Hello.
Tell us about your research.
All right. So I work in two areas mainly. The first area is in lunar surface studies. And they're laboratory-centric. So if you remember, Jacob mentioned an experiment called SWRC, Southwest Ultraviolet Reflectance Chamber. What we do with that chamber is we actually examine how lunar soils and how replicant lunar soils, what we call JSC1A, fake lunar soil basically, responds to ultraviolet light. We see how the ultraviolet light reflects off of these soils. The end goal of these experiments are to be able to saturate some of these lunar soils with a little bit of water and bring it to a freezing temperature so it's frost in the soil, basically. And we can characterize the reflectance of these soils, their ability to reflect ultraviolet light, and correspond that to the data that we get from a instrument on board the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, which is a robotic spacecraft that's orbiting the moon right now, called LAMP. And LAMP is a special ultraviolet detection instrument on board that spacecraft. And there's data from that is strongly indicative of there being frost water on the surface of the moon in these permanently shaded regions. Lizeth may tell you a little bit more about that. But We do not know for sure how much water it's telling us there is, and these laboratory experiments are meant to clear that. So the upper left-hand image you see here in the slide is of the SWRC chamber itself, and in that lower left-hand image, that little square full of dirt, that's real lunar soil. That's actual soil from the surface of the moon. That was collected by the Apollo 11 astronauts, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin, when they went there to the surface of the moon. And that's really probably the neatest thing about this work is that we actually get to work with the real stuff from space,
cool.
Lunar soil. So anyway, and then the second area I work on is a laboratory simulations of what may be happening at Pluto's moon Charon. So if you look here at the image on the upper right-hand side, you see that moon as it appeared to New Horizons. And there's kind of a reddish area up there, if you see that. Well, that was a little bit of a mystery when it was first observed. I mean, this was literally some of the first imagery we had of that moon around Pluto. And the idea that was proposed by one of our colleagues on this project is that there's methane that is coming from Pluto as Pluto warms up during the summer and is depositing onto Charon, and that deposit being irradiated by ultraviolet light from space turns it that red color. So that chamber, which you see in the lower right-hand image there, is what we use to simulate that. So that's the second experiment that I work on.
Very cool. Yeah. So all of this research, are you doing this on your own? Are there a team of people working on it? Can you talk about that?
There's a team of people working on it. There's particular aspects of the studies that I lead, but as you discussed with Jacob, he's a technician on the project. There are multiple individuals I work with on the SWRC project. There are several individuals I work with on the Charon project, as I call it. And I've only just started delving into the work on the Charon project. My main thing so far has been with the SWRC and the Apollo soils. Eventually, there will be an experiment that I lead on that Charon project, but right now I've been more of a supporting researcher on that.
Very cool. For this moon dust, we'll call it. Is it like in a special case, like locked up at night so nobody steals it?
That's a very good question. There's a fireproof safe in the room that we keep the lunar soils in. Nice. You would not know lunar soils were in these containers within that safe unless you open them up to find out, because most of them are these little metal cylinders with a cap on them. And so, yeah, it's a different site when you see them.
Very cool. All right. So let me switch to your second slide. If you want to tell us a little bit about now the other side of what you do for fun.
Yeah, fun stuff. Okay. So these are my two most interesting hobbies. There's other things I do besides these things, but one, I am a licensed pilot. I fly for fun. It's been a little while since I've been up there. So I was originally from Hutchinson, Kansas. I went to Wichita State University for my undergrad, and that's where I earned my pilot's license. I was part of a flying club there. And then when I came here to Texas, I needed to find a flying club here to rent a plane with. And COVID happened, and yeah, I'm still working on that. So, and then the other thing is I play saxophone. Yes, I really love music a lot, actually. The image you see of me there, I don't have enough pictures of me playing the saxophone, unfortunately. So that's one of the few I have. That's of me with the Shocker Sound Pep Band when I was at Wichita State University. So I actually went on the road with the team to many of the tournament games and everything. I missed out on the year that they went to Final Four in Atlanta, but I was there for the year that we went all the way up to the Sweet 16, I think it was. We went against Notre Dame, and we lost, unfortunately, to Notre Dame in that game, but it was still a fun season though. So, and again, I love jazz music. I like rock too, but and classical as well, but I really love jazz music. So it's just probably some of the most fun I've ever had. And the experience of playing the saxophone with other people, you know, and in various school bands and things like that has probably been some of the most fun that I've had along
the way. Did you start playing the saxophone like in middle school?
I was in sixth grade. Okay. Entering sixth grade, yes. So we tried out on instruments at the end of my fifth grade year.
Right.
Yeah. And my dad actually had this trumpet. He had this trumpet and cornet, and I kind of fiddled around with those things. And so I actually was better on that mouthpiece than I was in the saxophone mouthpiece originally. So the music instructors really wanted me to play trumpet, and I said, no, I'm playing saxophone. And nice. I'm glad I did.
Yeah. Well, it looks like you stuck with it. And the question for flying, how old do you have to be in order to get your pilot's license?
I think you have to be 17 to start training, if I'm not mistaken. I think you might have to be 18 to actually get the full-fledged license. But I think you can be 17 and start training. I'd have to check that again to make sure. But
yeah, because
I used to have to remember that stuff because I was a part-time space science educator at the space museum back home called the Cosmosphere. Great museum if you ever get the chance to go. And there, we did these Boy Scout aviation badge programs, and I had to explain all that to the Boy Scout groups. Yeah.
Very awesome. Well, thank you, Caleb, and I'll bring you back up in a minute because we have one more guest. So Lizeth, she's having a couple issues with her camera, but we have your photo. Can you hear us?
Yes. Hi, everyone. So for my research, I am part of the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter team that Caleb just talked about. So as the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter is orbiting around the moon, that's the picture I have here in the top left. It's constantly taking data as it's going around. And so we have a team of people that has to analyze all of this data. And I get to be one of those people. So essentially what we do is we compile all of this information together, and that allows us to make maps like the one that we're seeing here. And then these dark circles that you're seeing are the permanently shadowed regions that Caleb also mentioned. And this is where we think the ice is. So my job that I'm doing right now is analyzing the data that we get back from the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter and looking for evidence of water ice.
Very cool. And what are the black grid lines?
Yeah, the black grid lines here are just the longitudes.
Got it. So this is, did you mention, was this the North or the South Pole?
This is actually a picture of the South Pole.
Okay, very cool. And I know there you mentioned, or you discussed this further in the video. So if students still had questions, definitely make sure they check that out. Okay, so let me switch to your next slide because you had a lot of very fun hobbies. So if you want to just give us an overview.
Yeah, so this is actually just one hobby. I love to travel. So last year I got to go to Paris. I have a picture of me holding up the Eiffel Tower here. With COVID, I haven't been able to really travel abroad or anything. The picture on the bottom left is actually from Aruba. So I went to go see the flamingos there. So what I've been doing during COVID is some COVID-friendly hiking and backpacking. So these are all photos that I took or I'm in while traveling, hiking. And then the video that's playing here is the bear. This actually we took last week. We went backpacking, which means we hiked out to the middle of nowhere and slept outside with all the bears and yeah, it's not really any campsites or anyone out there. So we just got to pitch a tent and watch bears.
Where was this?
This one is from Big Bend National Park. Yeah, they have a lot of bears there. So.
And they're just casually walking around and you're just hanging out?
Exactly, yeah. When I went last year, we actually had to throw some rocks at the bears to scare them away because they were getting a little too close. As you can see from this video, they were a lot further away this time.
Wow. Okay, well, that's a good place to end. So thanks guys for sharing. So I'm gonna stop sharing my screen here and so we can see everybody. And I saw a couple questions and asked them if you just wanna kick us off with some questions from the teams that they submitted.
Yeah, so the first one, we got so many questions. I have like a whole list right here, so I'm not gonna get to everybody's questions, but the first one I'm going to start out with is when and why did you get interested in physics and astronomy? So like, what was it that inspired you guys? Like, where did that like love and passion start? So do we want to like go around in a, like a circle, Natasha, or just have them? Okay. Yeah. So whoever wants to go first to answer that question.
All right, Jacob. Mine's super easy. In high school, actually, I was also very interested in airplanes, in aerospace as well. And I remember I was helping my best friend's grandfather build an airplane when I was 15. And actually, you can get your pilot's license at that time as well. I believe it was 15. I got mine when I was 16, actually. I didn't know about that. Sorry, Caleb. Anyways, back to the question. I was already into aerospace, and I was getting into physics, and I was really interested in space. And the man I was helping build the airplane with bought me a book that was A Brief History of Time and Universe in a Nutshell combination book by Stephen Hawking. And I was hooked ever since then.
Very cool. All right, Caleb.
All right. First of all, to answer your question, Jacob, on the pilot's license, I think it depends on the kind of license. I think the sport pilot, you can be 15 going on 16. So anyway, but yeah, mine actually started with airplanes too, to some extent. When I was about 3.5 years old, my dad took me to an air show at the local airport, and they had this KC-135 tanker jet parked down the runway. You could walk through it. Hutchinson, Kansas, where I grew up, is just a little bit north of Wichita. And McConnell Air Force Base in Wichita is actually one of the main bases for KC-135 refuelers. And we were able to walk through the plane and everything. And I just fell in love with this idea of flying and going into space. And it just kind of grew from there. I bought my own telescope when I was 7 years old. I saved up every penny I could to do so. And I just fell in love with this idea of space flight and going into space and seeing what was out there, you know?
Yeah. So. All right, Lizeth.
Yes, my interest in space began like my second year of high school, where we had one unit in biology class that we could do a research project on anything we wanted. So I just started looking at different areas of science that there were. Ended up writing my research paper on space, and I didn't realize that, you know, in order to study space, you need to know physics, until I was about to graduate, and I was trying to major in something space related, and my advisor told me, well, if you want to do space, you need to do physics, so here I am.
Awesome. Yeah, I love how y'all all have, like, different stories, and you all, like, ended up in the same place. That's so cool. All right. And that question was from Meteorites in New Jersey. So thank you guys for that question. And then the next question I have is, this one is from Space Cows in Monterio. What is it like being a physics, you know, graduate student or undergraduate student? So if you can maybe, you know, list some skills that you use on an everyday basis, or just give us an idea of what, like, a day looks like. Like, are you in the lab a lot? Do you interact, you know, in groups a lot? Do you write papers? Do you do experiments all day? Like, a very short glimpse of, like, what that kind of looks like.
Sure, I'll start off here. So for my work, as I mentioned, I analyze data from the spacecraft. So my typical day just looks like me sitting in front of my laptop coding all day. So if you're interested in coding, this is for you.
Very cool. All right. And Jacob or Caleb, do you guys have anything to add?
I can expand on that. So yeah, again, I think I'll echo what Lizeth said, and I know Jacob touched on a little bit of it earlier. Number one anymore really is computer programming skills. I think that's probably the number one. Number two, generally, no mathematics, know how mathematics works. And number three, and I'd put it on equal footing with the rest, written and verbal communication skills. That is something you really want to hone to be in this field, especially if you're going to be publishing and talking about research at conferences and things like that. And yeah, I think that's another one I'd really drive home is the written and verbal communication skills.
Yeah, I feel like that's something a lot of people forget about when they, you know, they think of science and scientists, and they're like, oh, I just do experiments and I just need math and science. But I think, like you said, communication is very important. All right, Jacob, do you have anything to add from your side?
Yeah, the question was, what's it like to be a physics student? Was that right?
Yeah, like, what are some skills or things you do kind of on a daily basis? What does it look like?
Well, I think one of the key things that I've had to learn is time management and stress management. And like Caleb was saying, you'd be very surprised how much you need good communication skills. Working with such a large team who all have different backgrounds and specialties, being able to communicate what you know to someone that can understand in a way that they can understand it and things like that is very important. People don't stress that enough.
Yeah, I feel like that's always like the forgotten thing. And it sounds like, you know, to be in the field of physics, you need the math and the science and the communication all combined. So, all right. The next question I have is, this is from Sophia's Space Adventures in Illinois. Was your field hard for you to study? Did you find it easy? How was your journey to becoming where you are now?
I guess I can go ahead and take that one if you want.
Yeah.
Mine has not actually been the easiest by any means. And this is something I'd like to drive home for everyone. Don't never give up if you really want to do something in life. Never let much get to you or really discourage you. So going through middle school and high school, I really excelled in school during those years. And getting into college, I at first attempted double majoring in aerospace engineering and physics in undergrad. And this is the other thing you have to learn, you know what you can do and know when you may overstep some of your limits. And again, that doesn't mean give up, but what that does mean is frame what you want to do in a way that makes sense. That was too much. That was way too much to do in one sitting. So I chose what I loved most about it. And I loved the actual pure science, the physics and astronomy side of it. So I went with that and ran with it. And that worked out a lot better for me. Grad school, I actually had a false start. I applied to several different universities out of undergraduate education. And I was admitted to the University of Kansas in their PhD program. The first year in that just did not go well for me for a lot of different reasons. And so I wasn't able to continue there any longer. And I went back to my undergraduate institution, Wichita State University, to work on my master's degree there. It is kind of just a little slower way of going about doing it. And that I'm glad that happened. That was a lot of fun. It worked out exceptionally well. And I went through the application process again for PhD programs, and I made it into UTSA. I actually made it into two schools in that round out few that I applied to here and University of Alabama, Huntsville. And I'm glad I was accepted at UTSA. I've enjoyed it. I've been very successful here, and I'm glad it worked out the way it did, but it wasn't the smoothest ride. Not by any means. And I want to stress to everyone, you know, don't ever let anything really let you down too much. There's always a way. There's always a new start. And that's something that I'd really like to drive home. And perseverance matters.
You never give up.
Yeah. And I think that's the kind of the perfect message to tell students, especially at the middle school level where you might be getting discouraged. Because high school, it just keeps getting a little harder, taking more math and science classes. So just stick with it. I think that's the message I'm hearing from you guys. And so I want to end with one fun question that we always ask. So the students are on a mission to the moon. And so they're designing a lunar base. And we've talked a lot about astronauts and going to the moon. So I'm going to ask each of you, if you had to pick one item to take with you on a trip to the moon, something fun, not like food, whatever you want it to be, a personal item, what would it be? So I'm going to start with Jacob. He's thinking hard about this.
That's too hard of a question. You put me on the spot. Oh, man. One item to bring to the moon. And it has to be fun.
Whatever you want. All right, we're coming back to you. Lizeth, okay. You got one?
Yeah. So I guess if I only had to bring one item, I would bring a camera to capture the beauty and everything around me.
Nice. All right, we'll go to Caleb. Let Jacob think.
You know, I really should have been thinking along the Zest line. That actually makes a lot of sense, but I kind of figured that was included in the essential items package. Let's see, what would I actually take with me? Well, in order to just have fun in my spare time, probably a small soprano saxophone or something like that, you know. Let's see, what else could you possibly bring?
I think that's a good one. You can be
that is a good one.
Play on the moon.
yeah. Alan Shepard already stole the idea of bringing a golf club and a golf ball. So yeah.
All right, Jacob, it's on you now.
I don't mean to steal Lizeth, but I would probably go with a video camera just so I can. I was thinking about a journal to keep myself sane, but I think also just being able to record myself speaking, record the things around me. Though it would probably be deemed essential, I also think it would be something that could soak my time up as well.
Perfect. All right. So thank you again for joining us. And we've enjoyed, you know, listening to you. Thanks for your time and creating that video that the students watched. And so now we're going to move on because I know they're waiting for the next part, which are raffle prizes. You guys are welcome to hang out if you just want to turn off your cameras. And I am going to share my screen. Thanks, guys.
Yeah, no problem. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay. Awesome. All right. So project highlights. So this was a fun week. So last week you guys did the rover design. This was the last real building engineering design challenge. And I know some of you struggled, but you came up with some amazing designs. So let's play the video. Okay, and then I got a question about this. And so I wanted to make sure we announced our mission patch winners. So in Goose Chase, I think it was two missions ago, I gave our finalists. So teams submitted designs for a mission patch to represent our mission to the moon. And there were, I believe, six top teams. You guys voted, we tabulated the results. And our winner is this one, and I don't remember which team this is, but shout out to the team that designed this mission patch. So you guys, when you finish the Mission to the Moon program, we're going to send you a certificate that is going to feature this mission patch. And I just thought it was a really appropriate mission patch since we are doing Space Club in the middle of a pandemic. So very fitting that our astronaut is wearing a face mask. So awesome job, guys. And last but not least, now I'm going to call Aspen to do our weekly winners.
Woo! All right. So y'all did so good this week. I love seeing all your creative rover designs. Y'all came up with so many different types of designs. So the winner for this week will receive a drone. So it's so cool. You put your phone in the controller, you can fly it around, and it has a camera so you can take video. And so Natasha, if you want to play a demo of what the camera looks like on the quadcopter. And so again, you can fly and you have a big overview of everything.
We do not want that to happen though.
So hopefully a bird will not smack into your quadcopter or drone. So, all right, so for the team that won this. So for the Mission 6 raffle winner goes to Galaxy Invaders, Anson Jones Middle School, San Antonio, Texas. Woo! So congratulations, guys. And we will be getting to your club sponsor about getting you guys your prizes. And then last but not least, so remember, we're going to have our school prize announcement in December. As long as your team earns 25,000 points, your school will be entered in this competition, this raffle, for either a 3D printer, robot, or some model rockets. And so make sure to get your points in by December 8th to be entered into this raffle. And then just some last minute housekeeping. Next week is Thanksgiving break for most of you guys, so we will not have any programming next week. Mission 7 submissions are due November 30th, so make sure to get those in by that date, and so you have a little extra time to do that. And then December 2nd, we will have our week 8 career chat. We have a really, really cool speaker I'm really excited about. And then all missions need to be in by December 8th. So we extended the date a little bit for you guys to give you a little bit extra time. And then December 9th will be our final career chat and grand prize, whoever school has won the final prize. So make sure to keep going. I know Thanksgiving break and winter break is coming up. So keep going and keep submitting your awesome designs. So thanks so much for coming today. Natasha, do you have any last words?
I hope you guys have an awesome break and good luck in planning those lunar colonies. Just make sure you're looking at the checklist in your student handout and make sure it includes everything in that checklist. We are giving bonus points to teams that have everything labeled and that you're putting one unique thing in the caption. So just wanted to send that reminder and make sure you're collecting recycled materials, because the final mission is to build parts of your lunar base. So plastic containers, toilet paper rolls, cereal boxes, anything that could be used for building, you can cut it up and make walls or little chairs or whatever you want on your lunar base. Start collecting that, because that's what's coming up. All right, well, that's it for us. You guys have a great break and we'll see you after.